Hi, Jeff Spira here, and today I want to talk to you about fiberglassing. I get a lot of questions about fiberglassing because I recommend that you fiberglass the outside of my boats when you build them. So I thought I'd fill you in on what that's all about. So again, I recommend fiberglassing all of my boats on the outside only. This does several things. First, it seals the boat, make sure it doesn't leak, water doesn't leak through, and it strengthens the skin considerably, not only from the normal hydrodynamic loads, but also in impact strength, which means to me bash resistance. So if you run over an exposed rock or coral, or land on a gravelly beach, or run into one of the millions of things that are out there that you can run into on the water. It just makes sure your hull doesn't come apart, and it makes sure that that holes that are punched in a lot less easily than if there was not fiberglass there. Now, it doesn't completely eliminate it, but it does improve things quite a bit. So I do not recommend fiberglassing the inside, except on larger stitch and glue boats, which the inside fiberglass there is there for strength anyway. So it's extraordinarily difficult to fiberglass the inside. There's lots of nooks and crannies and internal radii and all sorts of issues that would make it nearly impossible to do that by hand. Now, you might be able to spray glass in there, the chopper gun type thing, but it doesn't make sense to do it. And if you tried to do it, you would leave places that water could get through to go through the fiberglass skin and where there's bubbles and this and that and leakage places and things like that. And because most of the water that goes into a boat comes in from rain, so that's how you're going to get water on the inside. Now, if water does get in there and gets trapped under the inside glass, it's going to rot. The inside hull is going to rot. Remember, I don't design fiberglass boats. I design wood composite boats, wood unibody type structures. The wood is critical to the strength of the hull and the plywood covering. So one common question I get is, can you get away without fiberglassing the boats? And generally I tell people, yes, you can, but since I generally specify pretty standard construction grade materials like AC exterior plywood, for instance, it has internal voids that take away from its overall strength. But marine ply does not have internal voids, so it is it's stronger. So if you were to not want to fiberglass the boat, I would recommend you upgrade the materials to marine grade, or you can also use hardwood plies with exterior glue in them. They make Baltic birch and mahogany and even the Home Depot sandy wood plies are can be used too. So they're a lot stronger than ACX or CDX or whatever you decide to use. Remember though, if you switch from standard ply to marine ply, it's going to cost a lot more than it will to buy the fiberglass and cloth and the epoxy and cloth enough to fiberglass the boat. So it doesn't make any financial sense really. But you may be allergic to epoxy. There's other things so like that. The other question I get a lot is that people ask me if they can use polyester resin instead of epoxy because it's cheaper. Well, back in the 1960s, Trimarans, home-built, fiberglassed over plywood trimarans were very, very popular. You know, every you know, hippie that wanted to be a vagabond instead of going to van life like they do now, they bought a trimaran and figured they would you know, cruise the Caribbean or the South Pacific or something with it. And and also the other group that that really liked them were the people that are involved in extreme sports nowadays. I mean, there was no such thing as zip lines and you know, off-road bicycles or parkour or any of these things that were these are all new things that were invented in the last, you know, 30 years or so. And back then they just didn't have any of those things. So guys would build tries, and they would, every blowy day or when there's a gale warning out, all the tries would head out in the afternoon and stand them up on one end, one pontoon, and, you know, a lot of them ended up turtling out there. So, but anyway, these trimarans were pretty heavily loaded, so the hull flexed a lot, and the ply was covered with glass cloth and polyester resin. So, you know, when out on the water in a rough day, sometimes that whole sheeting, the polyester and glass, would peel right off. It would delaminate and just fall off in huge hunks. And a lot of boats sank that way or had a lot of trouble. So a lesson was learned in those days based on that, and it's polyester is a good laminating resin. It'll stick well to the fiberglass, but it's a really poor glue, and it doesn't stick to wood well, particularly not plywood that's sanded very smooth, like the outside skin of plywood is. So, I used to build in Morro Bay when I was in college. You know, this was in the early 70s. I helped build some Radencraft commercial fishing boats, and these were they were dive boats, particularly, and they were built. It was kind of a stitch and glue method. They were stapled together instead of stitching out of half inch just BCX or CDX plywood, and then they were fiberglassed over fairly heavily inside and out. But what we had to do to make sure that this fiberglass didn't peel off was staple down the fiberglass layers. There were seven or eight layers. I don't remember exactly. It varied with the boat size, but they were matte, roving, and cloth. They used multiple layers of it. So we would have to staple the layer of cloth down, and then fill it, and then staple the next layer of cloth down, and then fill it, too, on top of it. So, you know, if you were to try and do that on one of my boats where you're using just 6 ounce cloth, you'd have to use galvanized staples. What we used to use were hot dip galvanized staples. So. And the cost of epoxy has come down quite a bit since then. You know, back then, you know, polyester was $20 a gallon, epoxy was $80, but now polyester is $40 and epoxy is $60 or something like that, or $35 and $60, something like that, so, or $70 a gallon. So the epoxy is much cheaper than it was back then relative to polyester, and you don't have to go out and buy stainless steel staples and a method to install them and then go through all that extra labor. So again, you're not really saving much by trying to go to polyester, because you have to staple down the glass cloth to the plywood. So and, you know, again, I normally recommend two layers of 6 ounce cloth on most of my power boats. You can kick it up more if you want. You can go to 10 ounce or whatever, but I would not recommend you only going to one layer. Even, you know, two layers of 6 ounce are a lot more consistent than one layer of 12 ounce, for instance. So you could also thin the ply a little bit and then add another layer of cloth as well. So that would work. So. One of the next questions I get a lot, and people don't really follow, is that I recommend linear yards. I will say in my bill of materials, this takes 14 yards of polyester cloth or something. But those are not square yards. The Chinese came out and made 36 inch wide cloth, but But fabrics in the U.S. are never made in a yard by yard, you know, dimensions. They're not made in 1 yard wide rolls. They're made in longer rolls than that. And typically, cloth is made in 50 inch wide, most of the commercial looms. So fiberglass cloth you buy will be typically 50 inches. Again, the Chinese came out with, and they wanted it to look cheaper, so they only gave you a 36 inch wide cloth instead of a 50 inch wide piece of cloth, and say, hey, look, ours is only 2/3 the price. So if you want to use the cheap cloth, that's fine, but you got to do your own math. 14 yards of 50 inch wide is 14 times 50 divided by 36, and you get almost 20 yards. So you need to buy more if you're going to use narrower cloth. I also don't figure the fit in. I just calculate the square footage. So people will call me and they say, well, if I put four layers of cloth on here, one on each side of the bottom and then one on each side, that's going to take 22 yards, not 14. You know, what are you talking about? And yeah, it might, but what's going to happen is that you're going to throw away 8 yards of cloth just because you're going to trim it off the sides. So, I don't give you a pattern to cut this out, and it just doesn't make sense to use the least amount of scrap. You know, cloth is pretty inexpensive, so I'd buy extra. That would be my recommendation. Or you need to piece together the pieces you trim off. You know, the pieces you trim won't have to be saturated with epoxy, so you're not going to waste the epoxy resin to fill them. All you're going to do is cut them off and wad them up and throw them away. So, so anyway, you can piece together the small pieces into strips and that sort of thing. It can be a patchwork of small pieces. It doesn't necessarily have to be big long pieces that cover the whole boat, as long as the seams don't really match up. So, okay, so before you fiberglass, you want to fill and smooth out your boat. Fill in any seams, any screw holes, any little hole that's in the deck screws you want to fill. You can do that by taking some epoxy and mixing it up and then filling the epoxy to make a Bondo-ish kind of material. So the easiest thing to use is just the sawdust out of your sander. So if you have fine sawdust, that's perfect. Or you can buy a filler material. You know, I used to use Cabasil. It's a silica thing that, like, little tiny snowflakes of glass. You know, silica is glass. So there's also pecan flour, which you can buy, talcum powder. And there's a thing called microspheres, which are little tiny glass balloons, I guess. They're very, very small, but they're hollow. And the microspheres are the easiest ones to sand. You sand the material and it sands very nicely. But other stuff like Cabasil is a little more difficult. But flour is fine though too, and as is talcum powder. So. Anyway, you want to mix that with the epoxy until it's about the consistency of peanut butter. And then you just put it on a spatula kind of thing, you know, and butter it on the holes and the little depressions and the screw threads and screw holes and slots or whatever. And then just butter it on and then let it cure, and it'll come out pretty nice. Next, you're going to want to sand the hulls, which means you round the corners and flatten any raised areas of any of the drips and drools that come through or whatever of glue and that kind of thing. So you want to get the thing fairly smooth. The best thing to do, in my mind, is use a random orbital sander, and then around the corners you can use an angle grinder type of thing if you want to round the edges and all that. But you want it to have a pretty nice, consistent surface area, and it'd be nice to sand some of the epoxy with a little bit fiberglass so that it can take the epoxy better. So, you know, sanding it with some, 120 grit or whatever in a random orbital sander will give it some scratches and give it some surface area that the epoxy will stick even better to. So when you're ready to fiberglass, it all can be done in one day, and I tend to do that that way myself. So for most of my boats, so you cut out the glass cloth to cover the panels, maybe an inch overlap around the seams and such, and then set that cloth aside and make a second cutout of the same panels as well. It's better to have the seams in different places, as I mentioned earlier, the two layers, as long as the seams aren't in the same place, so makes a better fit. So then you mix up a batch of unfilled epoxy and paint the hull with it before you lay anything down. Then you put the layer of cloth onto the wet epoxy while it's still wet, and then make some more epoxy and paint over the first layer of cloth. Well, you're going to stretch the cloth out and make sure there's no folds or too many wrinkles or that kind of thing, or bubbles or whatever. And then you paint over it and you wet the epoxy. And I use the end of a disposable brush typically, and you poke it at the thing, and it'll drive the epoxy and make sure it gets all wet. You can tell when it's wet because it goes from a white color to a more clear, you won't even see the cloth there. And a lot of the boats that use that, you may see on my website that show the grain through it are fiberglassed over, but you don't even see the fiberglass. So anyway, you get that layer on, and then while that layer is still wet, you put the next layer of cloth on, and again, you're going to want to stretch it out, make sure it's there's no folds or too many wrinkles or that sort of thing, and it'll stick to the wet epoxy underneath. Of course, then you paint over that, and again, fill all the places that you see there's bubbles or white spots or whatever, and do a little poking with the end of the disposable brushes. I buy one of those inexpensive disposable brushes. You buy a box of a dozen or something, 2-inch wide or whatever, and then do the whole surface. Next, what you should do, or what I think is the best thing to do, is take a epoxy roller, and it's what it is. It looks like a paint roller, but it's metal, and it's pretty small diameter. And you can clean it with vinegar. So you only need one, or acetone if you want, and then just roll over the outside of it after they're two in. That pushes it all down and makes sure it's all, compressed as much as you can, because the trick here is to get the least amount of epoxy and the most amount of glass in the surface. So. So back in the old days, there was real wax paper that you could buy in the grocery store. You can still get it at restaurant supply stores. I'll put a link below. I'll also put a link for the epoxy roller and brushes that I kind of like. Anyway, if you were to lay this old fashioned, wax paper over the glass and then roll it down and then let the glass go off, let the epoxy cure, and you can peel it off. But you know, modern stuff that you buy in the grocery store won't do that, or in the something that you would buy in the dollar store or whatever. It doesn't have enough wax on it, so it'll stick. It'll stick to epoxy, so that'll turn into a mess too. So. But if you buy the good stuff, and again, I'll leave a link down below where you can get it on Amazon. So it's restaurant grade, I guess, is what you call it. So, and then you can lay it over the epoxy, and then roll over it with anything. It could be a dowel, something like that, a cake, roller, kitchen kind of roller, something like that. And then again, let the epoxy cure and then peel off the paper. So it'll take out that weave sort of thing that you see when epoxy goes off without having anything on it. So it'll flatten that out, and so it'll be pretty flat and smooth. So it'll be much, much, much easier to sand, because sanding it after it cures with that weave pattern is tough. I mean, it takes a long time. It takes a lot of paper. It takes a lot of patience, and it's a problem. I think I'm not a big epoxy sander. Trust me. You got to wear PPE. You've got to wear a respirator and goggles and glasses and a shirt that you're going to throw away or whatever. So it's itchy, and it's not the ideal thing for woodworkers, let me tell you. So now I have a personal favorite place to buy epoxy and cloth and filler, and it's a guy I know down in San Diego. I've spoken with him on the phone. He knows a lot about boat building. He knows a lot about my boats and all that. And he also sells on Amazon. And I will connect you with some links down below. So some people like to use West System epoxy, things like that. Raka epoxy. Some people like that. So you're welcome to use those. I don't have any particular favorite need, to use my friends, and it's not, again, anybody's is fine. You can even buy the cheap stuff on eBay or whatever that comes from China. That's fine with me too. Don't get the epoxy that you would use there's new epoxy that you use encapsulate with. excuse me. You need to use really good epoxy that's intended for boat building and for laminating and gluing and that kind of thing. So, but my friends in San Diego there's one, and it works great for that. So, that's why I like it. It's also non-blushing. So if you want to put most epoxies, once they cure, you need to clean off the little blush coating, which is kind of a waxy coating that comes out. That you have to clean all that off before put another layer on top of it. So anyway, so that's the story of how, why, and with what you fiberglass my boats. So other builders may have their own recommendations, and fine, follow theirs. Other designers will have their own recommended methods to do it, and by all means use the one that the designer recommends. So. But if you're building one of my boats, this is how I would strongly recommend you do it. So, and it's the combination I find out works the best, and is the least amount of work, and is the easiest and fastest and strongest way to complete the my boat structures. So, okay, so be sure to like, share, and subscribe, and post any questions you might have or comments below. I love to hear from you, and always looking for new questions and new things that people are interested in me making new videos about. So I got a couple more that I'm planning to do pretty quickly here, and I hope you'll stick around and watch those too. So until then, thank you for watching, and I'll catch you on the next one.